Penguin Random House Audio presents Black Sheep by Rachel Harrison. Read for you by Jeremy Carlisle Parker. For the Bad Kids. 1. As I stood singing the birthday song for the fifth time that evening, I realized I was wrong for not believing in hell. Hell was the birthday song. Hell was shorties. Hell was the green polo shirt, the khakis, the whole stupid fucking uniform. Hell was my life. And the happy shorties happy birthday to you. Hey! I clapped and I thought, this must be it. This must be the summit of loathing. I imagined a climber atop Mount Everest, only bitter instead of victorious, grappling with their dissatisfaction with the view. Carrie presented the chocolate lava cake to the kid, and when he blew out the candle, we all applauded and whooped, and I longed to feel what I typically felt, which was numb, instead of what I felt in that moment, which was miserable. The kid's parents kissed his forehead, ruffled his hair. His sister asked meekly if she could try a bite. I observed them as I distributed extra spoons and napkins. And for the first time in a long time, I thought about my family. For the first time in a long time, I missed them. Or, if I'm being honest, which I suppose I should be. It was the first time in a long time that I admitted to myself I missed them, and how much. In that moment, I surrendered to the tidal pull of family, of blood. My hand found my neck, which was naked, absent the token of my youth, a sometimes coveted but more often resented piece of jewelry. You okay? Carrie asked, ushering me back to the kitchen. Sure, I said, unconvincingly. Awesome. Yeah, so I was wondering, she said, trailing off, distracted by a stain on her polo. Ugh, chocolate. That is chocolate sauce, right? Shit. Wondering what? I asked, checking the window for Table 8's order. Do you think you could cover my section till close? She asked, batting her lashes, flakes of mascara falling to her cheeks like ash. Why would I do that? I said, poking my head into the window to see what the line cooks were up to, suspicious they were once again slacking off. Because I'm asking very nicely, she said, and because you owe me.
I owe you?
I pick up your shifts all the time. I snorted.
When?
Last week.
I was sick, I said. It wasn't a lie. I was sick. Sick of working.
Please, Vess.
Why do you need to leave early? I said, sidestepping an overambitious busser who was barely balancing a tray of precariously piled dishes. She picked a waffle fry off of a plate in the window. A plate that was not for Table 8.
Sean.
Sean? I asked, dumbfounded.
Really? That guy? You're ditching work for that guy? You're so judgmental.
The guy treats you like a traveled toothbrush. He'll use you for a week straight, then forget about you for months, I said. And you either don't care or your self-esteem is too low to do anything about it. Either way, the whole thing is messed up.
Her jaw hung open for a moment, eyes widened like those of a child discovering something new about the world. Something brutal. Your burger was a cow. Moo. I knew this look. I defended her with my honesty, but the truth was the truth, and she needed to hear it from someone. Might as well have been me.
She crossed her arms over her chest.
Will you take my section or not?
I don't really want to be aiding and abetting, but sure. I'll do it. But I swear, if I have to sing that goddamn birthday song one more time, it's game over. Thanks, she said, turning on her heel. She paused on her way to the back room, looked over her shoulder at me. You know, you're not pretty enough to get away with being as mean as you are. And you're really pretty. I almost applauded. It wasn't easy to burn me, and she'd straight up smoked my ego.
Order up, got eight in the window, yelled one of the line cooks.
When I went to retrieve it, I thanked him, and then I heard him whisper under his breath,
You're welcome, Your Highness.
There were worse nicknames, worse insults, worse things. After 10 p.m., Shorty's turned into a cesspool of drunks and rubes, and some nights I'd have the patience for it, and other nights it'd make me want to cartwheel off a cliff. This night was one of the latter.
Four top at bar,
Amy, the host, told me while snapping her gum. Staff wasn't allowed to chew gum, but she did anyway, and I respected her unwavering commitment to such a small act of rebellion. Great, I said, checking the clock. Close was in less than 45 minutes, and I doubted this new table would be out by then, meaning I'd have to stay late. I cursed Carrie and her bad decisions. I cursed my own. I peeked over and saw that the party was four dudes, one in a backward baseball cap. If I smiled, feigned effervescence, maybe I'd improve my chances of a solid tip. But I doubted it. At that point, I'd been at Shorty's for 3 years and in the food service industry for 6. Ever since I left home at 18, I could tell just by looking at someone what they were going to tip, down to the cent. It was like shitty magic, like an evil fairy bestowed a cruel, useless gift on me. A highly specific power of foresight. Hey, how we doing tonight? I asked the guys, approaching the table, struggling to summon any artificial zest. My name is Vesper, and I'll be taking care of you. Can I start you off with something to drink, or do you need a minute?
Yeah, I'll take a... was how each of them ordered.
I kept my head down, scribbling in my book, trying to ignore the hot nudge of a stare. I was being scrutinized in a way that was, unfortunately, quite familiar to me. I knew in my gut what was coming. I considered running. This is what I get for thinking of them. For missing them, I thought. I've called them back in.
Vesper?
I looked up, instinctively, at the sound of my own name.
First of all, that's a rad name, the guy said.
He was the oldest at the table. About the right age, mid to late 30s, old enough to have snuck into her movies, to have rented the videos. He had a 5 o'clock shadow, wore all black. His ears had been gauged once upon a time. A former Hot Topic punk. He'd probably bought her poster, had it up on his wall. I knew the one. In a cemetery, she posed provocatively in black fishnets, a chainmail bra, and a signature piece of jewelry that everyone assumed she wore just to be cheeky.
Second, has anyone ever told you that you look exactly like Constance Wright?
Who? I asked. It was how I usually responded, because I knew it'd piss her off.
The Scream Queen? You know, the chick from Death Ransom, Bloody Midnight, Farm Possession, the Black Hallows Coven investigation?
I shook my head, deriving devious joy from the lie.
Seriously? You've never heard of any of those movies?
I'm not into horror, I said. Another lie. I should get those drinks in.
You don't need to be into horror to know Constance Wright. You have the exact same face, I swear to God.
He took out his phone, and I bailed. Be right back with those drinks. I'd hoped that by the time I returned to the table, they'd have moved on to another topic. But
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.